Crypto loans and interest-bearing accounts, are they safe? How will the shifting economy impact investor behavior? How is mining reshaping crypto? And how is crypto evolving against fiat currencies? So many questions. Welcome to Word on the Block, the series that takes a deeper dive into blockchain and the emerging technologies that shape our world at the intersection of business, politics, and economy. It's what we cover right here on Forkast News. I'm Forkast Editor-in-Chief Angie Lau. Well, crypto's notorious volatility can be too much of a risk for many investors, but now interest-bearing crypto accounts are gaining popularity. From Coinbase to BlockFi, Celsius Network, and more, these accounts allow investors to earn rates that can't be found in traditional bank accounts. But there's a question that a lot of our readers and our viewers ask us. Are these accounts safe? And how are they able to offer 15, sometimes 20% interest rates? What else is going on in the crypto world that these firms are innovating in? Well, my guest today is here to tell us how all this works, how the current economic conditions can impact the crypto market and beyond, and how regulators might be honing in, and what it all means for the market and you. He's the man responsible for the Wi-Fi services in the New York City subway system and a pioneer in voice over IP, that's VoIP services, who has added another title to his long list of accomplishments. He's the founder and CEO of crypto lending platform Celsius Network, Alex Mashinsky. Alex, it is great to chat again. Welcome to the show.
Thanks, Angie. Great to be back.
Okay, let's start for a lot of people from square one. You started Celsius in 2017 with co-founders Nuke Goldstein and S. Daniel Leon. What was your vision? What did you see before the rest of us in the traditional industry? And how did you emerge from 2017 into what we see today in 2021?
Sure, great question. The crypto world basically had two waves of innovation. The first wave, Bitcoin, Ethereum, were effectively exceptional stores of value. Both outperformed any other asset class or any stock or bond in the past decade. But now we're seeing a second wave of innovation. Celsius really was the first company to create yield on the blockchain. Before DeFi, before all these things that you're hearing about in the news every day, Celsius basically said you can pay yield on Bitcoin, on Ethereum, on stablecoins. And we innovated in creating basically the first platform that paid in kind. You didn't have to trade. You didn't have to do anything. You just download the app. You open an account. You deposit your crypto. And it's every Monday you get paid interest on that crypto. Today, there's 50 or so companies that are copying what Celsius has created, which is great. We have amazing validation from companies like Coinbase and others. But Celsius is by far the largest leader with over 15 billion in assets and close to a million customers or earning yield on our platform.
A million customers. Did you ever envision that that would be the case 4 years later? I mean, you guys are practically still toddlers right now.
So we are one of the fastest growing companies in history. We have 400 employees. And basically, if you look at that asset accumulation, it's probably one of the fastest in history. But what's important is really what we provided the community. We paid the community over $700 million in interest in a world where banks pay you nothing, right? So you can't earn anything on your money. And here comes Celsius and says, that's just not true. Right, you can earn 8.8% on your stablecoin. You can earn 6.2% on your Bitcoin, and most people look at it like you said before, right? In your preempt, that they're saying that's not possible. But every public bank files with their Securities and Exchange Commission or with a regulator, and they report their quarterly numbers. And in those numbers, you will plainly see that the bank makes 15 to 17%. They just choose to pay all that profit to their shareholders and not to their depositors, right? Not to their users. So all Celsius did is basically used exactly the same tactics banks use to earn yield. But instead of giving it to the shareholders, we chose to give most of that back to our users.
All right, let's break it down, because the structure of Celsius is interesting here, as you said. But also in some parts of the world, very controversial in parts of the industry, still deemed strategically controversial. So let's talk about that. Structure is essentially a bank, a community trust. Per your literature, as you've said, 80% of Celsius revenues go back to network users. The other 20% goes back to grow the company. You have a native cell token. You're bridging CeFi to a DeFi world. Explain how it works, how it all comes together technically.
Yeah, so we aggregate, again, these million customers, right? So we create a pool of Bitcoin. And right now we have, for example, just over 110,000 Bitcoins. So it's about, whatever, half of 1% of all the Bitcoins. Right. Yeah, half of 1% of all the Bitcoins in the world. And that Bitcoin is then being lent to institutions, exchanges, DeFi. We use it also, we invest in mining, and all those sources create yield. An institution has to pay us interest, right? The mining platforms pay us Bitcoin because they actually mint Bitcoin from the blockchain, right? So all those things are sources of revenues, and we publish a rate. The rate is based on what we earned the week before. And that rate translates to anywhere. Sometimes it's 70%, sometimes it's 90%. Sometimes we pay actually over 100%, right? So it depends really on how much we're earning versus how many Bitcoins we have. And the rates go up and down. So for example, stablecoins have varied between 6 and 12%. Right now they're at 8.8. That's the highest rate you can earn anywhere. It's twice as much of what Coinbase pays you right now. And the reason for that is that we have five sources of yield, right? So our stool has five sources where most of our competitors have only one source, right? They're using the GBTC arbitrage, or they're using some other source. Now, most exchanges, most of other companies, they are relying on charging you fees. They sell you a Bitcoin, they charge you a fee. They make you move stuff around, they charge you a fee, right? Celsius does not charge its customers any fees. We have to create yield, and we keep a small portion of it. You get to keep most of it. So it's a very, very different business model. And you asked about Celsius and why did we come to be. Our mission was to create a new financial system for the people, by the people, a platform that will always act in the best interest of our community. And our mission, you can read our white paper from 2017. Our mission from day one was to bring 100 million new people into crypto. And that's also what's going to make Bitcoin, Ethereum, all these other coins much more valuable. So we are 1% in, right? We've managed to deliver 1% of our target. And I'm sure now it's going to move much faster as we're accelerating what we've built, what took us 3 or 4 years to put together.
And I can just hear the worrying because it's happening in my brain, and no doubt a lot of people trying to do their math here right now. Currently, as we speak, Bitcoin is at 31,000. You have 110. You know, a couple of months ago, it was at 65. That is a massive drop, 50% drop. And so, you know, that must have had an impact on the value of the Bitcoin and your ability to leverage that in, you know, in yield. How have you dealt with that kind of volatility? What's the internal mechanism that allows you to do so?
Yeah, so first, that drawdown, the 53% drawdown actually happened in almost one day. So in Celsius, we have 350 institutional counterparties. None of them defaulted on their loan. None of them was late paying the interest. Most of them posted more collateral. We had thousands of margin calls, but none of our counterparties has defaulted. In the financial system, if you have a 50% drawdown, every bank that you know will go out of business. The Fed is going to have to jump in and save all of them. So here, the crypto community has proven that it's resilient and it does not use leverage, unlike the traditional banks that are leveraged 20-to-1 and they use fractional reserves and all this fancy financial tools. Again, they flip a coin, it lands on heads, they get giant bonuses. It lands on tail, the Fed shows up and bails them out, right? So the crypto community doesn't have those options. So we have to operate in a way that makes sure that we are resilient. So Celsius does not bet on assets. It's not like we invest in Bitcoin and we hope it's going to go up. Our job is really to create yield, just to create interest. Our customers are the ones that are saying, I'm going to put my money into Bitcoin or I'm going to put my money into stablecoins. Obviously, stablecoins did not have any losses because they're pegged to the US dollar. So we continue to pay 8.8% on stablecoins and we continue to pay 6.2% on Bitcoin. It doesn't matter if it's 60,000 or 30,000. So Celsius really creates more yield when there's volatility, when prices move up and down. That creates a lot of demand for arbitrage or for hedging or for market making. And that's where we can charge those institutions much more and deliver most of that back to the community. So we just raised actually our rates on Bitcoin. We raised them higher because of the volatility. So yeah, the price of Bitcoin went down, but our community, our million users, they're all hodlers. They don't care what the price is today. They care what the price is in 2030. And between now and then, Celsius allows them to earn that 6% a year. You compound that and you're going to have twice as many coins by 2030.
You know, that is really counter to what other competitors in the market have been doing, which is cut interest rates on Bitcoin. And you've done the opposite.
That's right. So the reason we can raise rates is because, like I said, we have five legs to the stool. So sometimes, like right now, the rates on DeFi are down 90%. The rates on exchanges, the volume on exchanges is down 40%. But our institutional business, our mining business has never done better. Chinese miners have shut down because of the crackdown. Celsius is making almost twice as many Bitcoins as it projected because of this change. The institutional business is doing phenomenally well. So we can basically, because we have all these different options, our business does not rely just on, okay, DeFi on Ethereum, right? We support 14 different blockchains and we can run on different blockchains and as a CeFi, not as a DeFi, right? Celsius is a centralized finance. We have a bridge. We have one leg in traditional finance, one leg in DeFi, and we can basically deliver. We are the bridge that delivers billions of dollars between the two worlds to take advantage of yields. And when DeFi doesn't deliver the yield, we just take that money, put it in one of the other buckets.
I mean, I think in terms of, you know, for most investors and healthy portfolios, you want to diversify your portfolio. And so you've got five legs from what I understand. Talk about mining.
Yeah. Five legs of yield and 42 different assets that you can diversify between.
Well, there you go. And mining is a significant one that you just mentioned. And breaking news right now, as we speak, and probably you know, by the time everybody else watches this, they will have heard this. But what are you doing in mining? There's a significant investment that you've made in mining. Tell us what it is.
So about a month ago, we announced over $200 million invested in mining operations, and we invested in three strategic companies in addition to actual mining facilities, Core Scientific, Rhodium, and Luxor. Core Scientific today announced they're going public with the merger with the SPAC here in the United States, the valuation of $4 billion. So that's obviously is phenomenal news, not just for Celsius, but also to our entire community, because their investment is doing very well. And again, we did this ahead of all of these crackdowns in China and all of the chaos that's going on, because for us, unlike other people who are investing dollars, hoping to mine Bitcoin, sell it and make dollars, Celsius is looking to make and retain and mint Bitcoin because we owe our community Bitcoin. We don't owe them dollars. If you gave me 100 Bitcoin, I have to give you 6.2 Bitcoin in total during the year. So 52 every week, I have to give you 1/52nd of that 6.2 Bitcoin. So if I build a Bitcoin factory, right, with Core or with Rhodium or with other companies, that is a guaranteed source of Bitcoin. So that we don't care what happens on exchanges or DeFi or institutions, if we have a factory that every 10 minutes prints 6.25 Bitcoin.
But as you said, you are the bridge between CeFi and DeFi. So you have one foot in traditional finance and then the other foot, obviously, in this brave new world of ours. I want to talk about, you know, what in traditional banking institutions would call securities lending, which is essentially, you know, depositing the dollars from users, lending it out to institutions, and then, you know, you're arbitraging in the middle. How do you view that? You've been asked about it. And, you know, how does that work within what you're doing at Celsius?
Sure. It's a great point because most of us have a brokerage account with Fidelity or Charles Schwab or E-Trade or Robinhood, right? They're supposed to be Robinhood. They're supposed to give us money back. But Robinhood takes your security. They take your Tesla stock, your Facebook stock, and you think you got the trade for free because you bought it with no commission. But Robinhood lends that shares or does SEC lending or securities lending into, for example, Citadel. Citadel does market making arbitrage and pays yield. They'll pay 5 or 10% a year on your stock, right? On your Tesla. Now, Robinhood does not give you that earnings. They take it to themselves. They give it to their shareholders. So the same thing is done in crypto, right? When an institution, an exchange borrows Bitcoin from us, does instead of SEC lending, they do digital asset lending, right? And they pay us interest. We could hide it and not tell anybody and take all that money, but instead we're giving most of that to our community. So really, Celsius is the real Robin Hood. Celsius is doing what Wall Street will not do for the last 200 years, right? No one on Wall Street has ever paid this money, the SEC lending income, to their customers, right? That's the best kept secret. Some of the largest firms on Wall Street, more than half of their income comes from SEC lending, right? So that's a sacred cow that no one on Wall Street was willing to share with their customers. So the innovation around what Celsius has done is basically break all the rules and say, no, the community, it's their money. They deserve to get all that income.
It sounds great. And a lot of people are probably saying, that's fantastic. What's the risk?
So if you ask any Wall Street veteran, what is the safest business on Wall Street? They're not going to tell you banking. They're not going to tell you trading. They're going to tell you SEC lending. That is the safest business on Wall Street. That is also the safest business in crypto. So like I said, Celsius went through several basically stress tests, right? March 2020, May 2021, a whole bear market in 2018, right? A bull market, several bull markets, 2017, 2020. And in all those markets, Celsius did not have a single default or a single liquidation with our institutional customers. So I'm very confident that we will continue to perform this well. Also, we have a very strong balance sheet with several billion dollars on it. So we know that we can deliver the yield, be profitable, and deliver everything we promised our community.
So I got to ask you, what happened with Prime Trust then?
Sure. So look, when you change your cable company, no one prints about it in the news and says, you know, Angie switched from Verizon to some other company.
So Celsius, AT&T.
Exactly. So someone decided that that is breaking news. And they decided to write all about it. It happens that that publication, their parent company owns 100% of our largest competitor. And all we did is we switched from provider A to provider B. All of our customers have moved over. All of our customers continue to get the same service. We don't have any issues. There's no problem. And like I said, for many of our customers, we even raised the rates because we started earning more. So Celsius has a lot of competition. Celsius has a lot of people who are trying to push us out of business because we are basically killing their golden goose, right? They're this source of yield that they created for themselves. And they're very upset that we have given it to their people. God forbid if all the people in the world will get access to yield, which was reserved only to the Wall Street clan. You know, that's what's really happening here.
Well, let's talk about the Wall Street clan, the market trend, and Bitcoin and crypto seen as an inflation hedge. And currently, we are experiencing that right now. We're seeing the consumer price index in the U.S. Rising. We're seeing a producer price index in China rising at extraordinary rates, which essentially means that the cost of goods made in China is going to eventually end up in stores, and you and I are going to have to pay for inflationary prices. You know, amidst all of that, amidst central bank with limitless, it seems, infinite printing of dollars, where do you see current market trend either supporting or affecting Bitcoin? And we do note that right now we are looking at 31, 32,000 US per Bitcoin prices right now.
Yeah. So look, I've been saying this first last year. I predict in January of 2020, you can see on my Twitter, I predicted we're going to hit 30,000 when Bitcoin, I think, was 4,000. And we hit it right on the nose in December or January 2021. We hit exactly 30,000. This year, I made a prediction that we're going to go all the way to 160, but we're going to close the year below 100. And more recently, I said that before we get there, we will actually revisit sub 30,000 because of the GBTC and the China liquidations. So those are my predictions. I'm sticking with those numbers. And it's not that I'm,
Didn't you also say 100? You said 160,000?
Yes, the peak. I'm expecting the peak price to be between 140 and 160,000 before the end of this year. But we will close below it because there's going to be a lot of sellers, a lot of people who are going to try to take profits when we hit new highs. But the most important thing is not that I'm giving you these numbers. The most important thing is that where I'm getting this data, right? So the Celsius community is the hodler community, right? Where these are people that hold coins forever. The prices you see on exchanges, that is the speculators. The last trade is not done by a hodler. It's in most cases done by somebody who's arbitraging or manipulating the market or buying and selling, trading the market. So what matters is 90% of the community, which is the hodler community. Are they adding assets or are they not adding assets? So last week was one of our best weeks ever. We added over $300 million in net assets in 1 week, right? So when the markets are going down, but I'm adding record assets, it tells me that the price is going in the wrong direction, that our community actually tells the truth and the price of Bitcoin is not telling you the truth. So, and we know why, right? We know because of the China crackdown, we know that, you know, billions of dollars of GBTC shares were getting unlocked, which put some pressure on the price of Bitcoin and so on. And I think we've had the correction and we're now going back to new all-time highs. And the question is just how quickly it's going to happen. You cannot continue and print all this money, right? I mean, the United States printed 40% of all the dollars ever created in the last 12 months. So that kind of the dollar inflation is 40%. The consumer price index increase is 5%. So you have to ask yourself, really, what is your protection against 40% monetary inflation? And you want an asset that has limited supply. Bitcoin, Ethereum, those are limited supply assets. They're quality assets. And that's why I think they're going to do very well compared to holding US dollars or some other fiat currency.
You know, we are seeing crypto behave a little bit more like the equity markets at the moment. But to your point, you know, things look very different from your neck of the woods. You know, I want to ask about the recent dip in Bitcoin prices. What can you tell us about the demand for institutional crypto loans in the Celsius network? And some of our custodian sources have told us that despite the dip, banks and institutions have not necessarily slowed down in adopting crypto as alternative assets for their portfolios. What are you seeing in your network?
Sure. So we are continuing to see a new record account creation for holders who are less than one Bitcoin. So we're not seeing any slowdown there. And it's not just Celsius. You can see the same thing if you go to Glassnode or other sources. You can see that the statistics for the blockchain itself are also an acceleration in new account creation. So that tells you that there's a lot of first-time buyers or first-time owners who come into the network. On the other side of it, again, institutional demand is very robust. New institutions, new desks that trade in Bitcoin are being added every day. Citibank announced one, Goldman Sachs, right? Even Bank of America, all the people who are on the fence are coming in, creating desks, and offering their clients all these different services. So I definitely, again, the price action in the exchanges, and the exchanges volume are down 40%. So the price action with the people who create all the volatility is down, but all the other stuff is still doing very, very well. And that's why I'm extremely optimistic. I have, again, hundreds of millions of dollars in personally in crypto. I'm the largest user. Just on Celsius Network, I have probably $320 million. So I'm long all these assets. But again, sometimes there's a correction like we've seen recently because of China and other resources. And you just have to weather the storm. You have to stay indoors until the storm passes.
You are putting your money where your mouth is, or your crypto where your mouth is.
I'm getting paid very good interest.
You're getting great interest. So there's self-interest, there's shared interest. You're in it with the rest of the users. There's no doubt that as more people come to the party is getting bigger. The liquidity, it's getting more exciting. But with that also comes, neighbors who don't appreciate that big party, and somebody calls the cops, right? And in the regulatory landscape, we're increasingly seeing that right now. And I'll just note BlockFi, one of your competitors, this week coming under legal microscope, a cease and desist order from New Jersey's acting attorney general saying that BlockFi's lending and trading services are unregistered securities that violate existing securities laws. I know it's not necessarily like for like, but they are a competitor of yours. They're in similar space. Are you nervous for Celsius?
So we operate in over 170 countries. We work with regulators worldwide. And there's a big difference between someone who's trying to sell you this or that asset and somebody who just creates yield for you. So it's true that BlockFi offers yield, but they're rates are 90% lower than ours. And really their focus is on trying to sell you Bitcoin, Ethereum, or other assets that may be deemed securities, right? So Celsius does not try to sell you anything. You must buy these assets somewhere else. Our job is just to earn that yield for you. So even though some may look at Celsius and BlockFi's competitors, they're really not competing with us on yield. We are offering, they're really competing with the bank on paying the least amount possible. We're offering some of the highest yield, but we're not trying to sell you the asset. We don't choose for you if you should buy this asset or that asset and try to make a fee or a commission on trying to sell you stuff. So I think where they got in trouble was basically them being a little bit too aggressive on basically trying to sell certain products. And if what you're selling is deemed a security, then you need to be a licensed broker dealer or you need to be a bank. And I don't think they hold those licenses.
So there's no doubt, regulators are clamping down, even yourself. I mean, Celsius is London-based, but you recently announced that potentially you're headed for the great United States, citing regulatory uncertainty in the UK. How do you deal with the regulatory ground shifting? So why leave UK? Why choose the US?
Well, we haven't left the UK. We still have many, many customers in the UK, and we continue to provide the same services, just like we continue providing services in New York. I think the United States has chosen to provide more clarity or provide more value to both mining and crypto companies. And the UK has chosen to basically have more strict regulation. So for us, for some of the things we do, we may benefit from being based in the United States. For example, if we choose to go public or if we choose to do some other financial activities, there's a big disconnect in valuation, as we've seen with Core Scientific, right, today. Core Scientific will not get half of that valuation if it was tried to list on the in London, right? So I think there's a lot of benefits, and for us, what we're trying to do is also capture the value in the company. We've allowed over 1,000 of our users to come in and join the bus, sit right next to me, not just as yield earners, not just as sell token holders, but also as equity holders. No other company offers that. Coinbase, you name a company in that offers crypto, none of them have allowed their community to come in and buy that equity and benefit from the increase in the value creation, right? So what we try to do is really be, like I said before, the Robin Hood of this industry, where if you are the one buying all your coins from Coinbase and they're now worth $90 billion, how much of that value are you capturing in the value creation? None of it, right? So that's what Celsius is trying to do, is really allow people to participate in all three buckets. And we'll be announcing our plans pretty soon. We are raising a round of funding. We're planning some of our other financial activities. And you'll see that we allowed our community to participate much better than anybody else.
Okay, you got my radar like completely up right now. Okay, so you're heading to the US. You're talking about, if I'm reading the tea leaves, potentially listing either through IPO or direct listing, or potentially even a SPAC. So which one of the three?
Well, so we are not, it's too early for us to decide which one. I think most companies in our space either do direct listing or SPAC. And if you look at my history, I've done two IPOs. I've taken my VoIP company public in 2004 and then worked with another public company. So I am my career has been working with private and public companies. So I'm comfortable with both, and we will see what happens. I mean, right now our plans are that we're open to all ideas, to all suggestions, but currently we're doing exceptionally well. Like I mentioned, we're growing. We doubled our business in 6 months. We've made phenomenal investments. And the most important thing is that our community continues to benefit from all of this. And we probably have one of the strongest community in crypto, right? That's really is the main pillar that holds Celsius together.
It's almost like I'm asking if you're going to run for president. It's like every time I'm sure it is this question. So it's almost like a cliche question. When are you going to go public? But, what's your valuation right now? If you're going to go to the market for another fundraise, we just heard, obviously, FTX raising $900 million, close to $1 billion. They're going to put that money to work. It's interesting that Coinbase is also one of the investors there. The crypto exchange space, this crypto space is very interesting right now. Coinbase, I think market cap right now sits at close to $47 billion. So question, how much are you going to the market to fundraise for? At what valuation?
So look, I think we should compare notes in a few months and I'll be able to talk about it. Right now, we are doing a round of funding. We announced that. We have our lead investor, so that's already done. And we are basically opening this round as well to our community. So we expect at least, last time, like I said, 1,000 participated, 2,500 people actually registered to sign up. I expect at least double that this time. So we expect to bring our community, create even more seats on the bus, and make sure that everybody gets to the finish line. Our mission, that 100 million people, it's not about just getting 100 million. The key is to get these 100 million people to achieve financial independence, to achieve financial freedom, right? Today, if you go on our website, celsius.network, you will see we list our top 500 holders that have either sell token or equity with us, and almost all of them are millionaires, right? Almost all of them who came and participated in Celsius got to benefit. It's not just I benefited because I created this company, or the employees of Celsius benefited because they got on the bus, right? The whole point is to take the whole village with you, because the financial world we live in, the traditional finance world, does not operate that way. You know, we celebrate the people who display the most greed, not the ones who display the most generosity. And then they get to be 60 years old and they pepper a little bit of money on some charities. And we say, look how generous they are. So the point is to, this is my third unicorn. Okay. I didn't do this for the money, right? But the point for me was to bring the whole village with me to the finish line, because it's not difficult. This is not some secret that you learned on Wall Street, and because of that, you get paid $100 million a year. The whole point of all of this is to show how simple and how universal yield could be, and how 7.8 billion people can join and all benefit. No one loses. The only people who lose are the people who used to hoard all that money and keep it all to themselves. I call this decentralized Buddhism. That's what I believe in.
Well, decentralized Buddhism also means, you know, go with the flow. So let's talk about it. How are you going with the flow? How are you going to be putting your capital to work? And talk about, you know, the partnerships that you have right now, notably Horizon, which together you've launched what is called the Zero Knowledge Audit, or a decentralized blockchain-based audit system that preserves privacy. Talk about how you're going to put this money raised in, you know, VC world, in fiat dollars, put it in crypto, and then put that crypto to work in decentralized, you know, reality.
Right. So one important component of creating value and creating yield is also transparency. And unfortunately, we all have seen in 2008, when Lehman Brothers went bust, they went bankrupt in 2008. And just a few months earlier, their auditor told all of us that they're a great company and they're going to continue to do very well, right? So this whole idea of double entry accounting system with an external auditor that audits you a year later is something that may have been around for 700 years since basically the Medici invented the system. It does not work anymore. So what Celsius together with Horizon created is a real-time audit trail, right? That uses the blockchain, but it's what we call triple entry accounting system. It's your traditional double entry. So Celsius reports certain things, but then you can verify that in real time on the blockchain. So we publish our numbers every week. You can see on our app, you can see on our website, how much we have in assets, what did we earn, how much did we pay the community, who got what. You can actually see everybody else. You don't know their name, hence zero proof, but you know what the number one earner in Celsius earned. It happens to be me, but you can see exactly what was paid to Alex Mashinsky, and you can see your ranking versus my ranking. Now, imagine that with your bank. Imagine going to your bank, giving them your paycheck and saying, I want to know what you do with my money. I want to know where you deploy it. How much are you earning on it? How much you are paying me? And by the way, I want to know all the other customers in the bank and see if I'm getting my fair share. Because I'm 1% of your assets. Am I getting 1% of the income? So obviously, there's no financial institution in the world that will ever do that for you. But that's what proof of community, or our project, right, of this zero proof knowledge enables you to do. Because on the blockchain, all of that is possible. And if you have an institution that actually cares for you and is acting in your best interest, then they should have no problem opening the kimono and sharing with you all this information, right? So that's really the difference between traditional finance and companies like Celsius.
So kind of like on-chain analysis, except it's like crypto bank analysis, and it's completely obvious to everybody in the community what everybody is getting and doing.
Right. And all that data is available to anyone. Even if you're not a Celsius customer, you can go and verify data about the Celsius community, about others, because not everybody's a programmer, not everybody knows how to sift through tremendous amount of data. So we have what's called a reward explorer. It's like a crawler or a browser that allows you to see the data in a visualized way, like with charts and numbers and beautiful representation. And that's a community effort. The community built that to basically audit us and make sure that what Celsius says is true. So I think when you put all those pieces together, right, yields from sustainable sources, external audit, right, real-time information, you're creating an institution that hopefully outlasts me, right? An institution that can really be there for the people, by the people, because the vast majority of the value created here is being captured by the community. After all, they contributed the asset. They should be capturing most of the value. Today in our banking system, the Fed has lowered the rates to zero. They're really robbing people who have any dollars or any assets. So on one side, the government takes half of your money with taxes, and on the other side, the Fed is debasing your currency. So being squeezed between a rock and a hard place, most people don't understand that. Most people think, oh, it's Corona and this, and it has nothing to do with Corona.
And don't forget the middle layer where you're paying 2 to 3% management fees, crossing your fingers, hoping that you're going to make that back if the price of your equity rises.
That's right. So all we did, unfortunately, most of the companies in the crypto world are toll collectors. They're just not called this bank or that bank, but they do exactly the same thing. They're extracting a pound of flesh from you, no matter if Bitcoin goes up or goes down. And what Celsius really decided to do is really take this idea that yield plus compounding interest is the most powerful force in the universe, right? That is what can get you to that financial independence. So like you said, as long as you have diversification and as long as you average in and you have these different assets in your basket, you're going to do much better than what traditional finance is offering you, where the fees are more than what they're paying you. I mean, it's just crazy. Right.
Well, I'm going to call you the unicorn whisperer soon. If your aspiration to take Celsius to the next elevation proves successful. Alex Mashinsky, it was absolutely a pleasure. Appreciate it.
Well, I can definitely confirm that we're a unicorn. I can confirm that.
The unicorn whisper. Let's see how many more you can birth. Hey, Alex, I'm going to absolutely invite you back on the show when you're ready to tell us all about going public and all the rest in your next plans.
So thanks for having me back.
We'll get you back on there. And thanks so much for joining us, Alex. Appreciate it.
Great to be with you.
And thank you, everyone, for joining us on this latest episode of Word on the Block. I'm Angie Lau, editor-in-chief of Forkast News. Until the next time.